Throughout the closing years of the 19th century, one of the great themes running through all the arts is a yearning for death, a yearning for oblivion. Schoenberg's Remembrance is doing the same thing as Tristan and Isolde, but it's doing it from the other side of a psychological ocean. Once again, it's returning to D minor with endless yearning, but it's returning to the memory of a home which can no longer be. In this piece, I can hear Schoenberg's doubts and fears, his obsessive concern with the dark and lonely road he was following, and his regret and nostalgia for the 19th century romanticism he'd left behind. Throughout the movement, there are little expressive moments, like little shavings from the workbench of Tristan and Isolde, but repeated compulsively like a mantra. What I find particularly touching is the way that, at the end of the movement, all these things have been combined, like a kind of treasured but jumbled and torn up memory you might grasp at on the edge of sight and feeling, but which has in truth already vanished forever. Imagine an artist in the middle of the sea of all these possibilities, producing staggering art, but without the feeling of a foundation, a discipline to work in. It was left again to Schoenberg to try to find a way to replace tonality, to replace harmony, to try to find some frame in which people could work. Because in fact, the logic of complete freedom leads to the madhouse. We talked before of the idea of democracy in tones, losing the seven tones of the diatonic scale and replacing them with. Schoenberg realized that there had to be some way to manipulate these notes which would give an inherent structure to the piece. So if one was to take these notes at random, these 12 notes, and reorder them, for instance, so that all of the 12 notes are sounded before any other notes can be played, immediately there is a structure. Now, to start off with, this seemed like a very onerous burden, this tone row. But as Webern said, this wasn't a problem. It was actually salvation for them. If you take away harmony, you take away the ear's reference points. It becomes more and more difficult to write music that lasts any time at all. And to start off with, composers like Webern found that once they had played the 12 notes, what else was there to do? It was like a perfect little gem hung in the air. What else was there to do? The row I played before actually comes from the fourth of his five pieces for orchestra. This was, up to that time, still the shortest piece of classical music that had ever been written. It is exactly 19 seconds. The row is played only three times. But once again, these notes, which were... can be put together to form magical combinations. So the first 12 notes sound... And this is essentially whisper music. It's like a Japanese haiku, where there are only a certain number of syllables possible, but with which you can express profound truths. In the music of Webern, with all its simplicity, economy, and crystalline perfection, one's not only talking about the events that we hear, it's the spaces between the notes that have almost as much expression as the notes themselves.